Good morning, Grove Church. Come on, if you're not on your feet already, stand up with us. We're going to have church this morning. Give all our praise to the Lord. God, do what you want to. Do what you want to. Come on. It's your heart. Searching for, we want you and nothing more. Let your glory fill this place. We're alive in your presence. Sing that again. It's your heart.
My hope is built on nothing less. Somewhat and doesn't want me to preach the truth. Christ is the cornerstone of our faith. No matter what can come our way, He is the hope and salvation offered to everyone. We believe at this church and every church that names the name of Christ that God created everything. And when He created humankind, He said it is better than all creation. People are valuable to the Lord. They matter. All life, from conception to eternity, all life matters to the Lord. At Grove, we commit to speak the truth in love. So on a day like today, Sanctity of Life Sunday, we desire to proclaim two truths in love. The first truth is we cannot at all dissolve, dissipate, or de-emphasize the truth that we should do everything in our power according to God's holy word through legislation, through conversation, through our faith, through promotion, that life is precious and we should do all we can to affect our society to protect all life. With that truth spoken in love, there is a second truth that must be proclaimed just as loudly as the first. And that is, if there is somebody under the sound of my voice who has been touched by the sin of quelling a life, God says that there is no sin that is unable to be forgiven and cleansed. There is no sin, no guilt, no regret that is too deep, no one too far gone that God cannot restore. If you have been touched by this grievous choice, let me encourage you by the authority of God's word that it was wrong and it was a sin, but God can restore you. God can forgive you if you confess your sin. He is faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. But he doesn't just call you to walk around forgiven. He calls on you then to be the loudest proclaimer of his truth, the first truth that you can proclaim out of your mouth, that you must protect life. If God forgave you, you should be the loudest announcer of his truth. God can use you again. And God can forgive you. Life is precious. God can forgive anyone that's been touched by this grievous sin. And he can use you again. Amen, church? He can restore and use anyone. I was always taught that as a believer, we should not just curse the darkness, but we should also proactively turn on a light. Don't just curse the darkness, but turn on a light. And today we do it once again. We are excited to dedicate a little one to the Lord in honor of our conviction about how we feel about the Lord and his word and life. And I would like to invite, would you welcome the Sutton family to come? This is Matt and Ashton Sutton. This is little Emily. If you notice, Emily was dancing during the worship. They pulled her back. I turned over. I said, don't you stop her. No. This is her church. Yeah, by the way, if you feel like dancing during the worship, I won't stop you. I won't, but it's up to you. And this is little Ellie. The Sutton family is one of our many, many new families. They joined during the summer. They began to watch. See, she's already dancing. I love it. She's 3 years old. She's turning 4 in February, right? Cannot wait. February 27, is that right? I think that's right. They're one of our families that watched Grove and during the COVID online, and then they came last summer, and they quickly said, we want in on what God is doing at this place. So they're not even a year old in our Grove family, and so we're very happy that they're here. And they want to start their legacy. They want to start their legacy, their family legacy here, which we'll talk about today. Church, little Ellie is 1 year old. They have committed to raise her in the way of the Lord. I'm going to ask you a question, but first ask this couple. Do you, Matt and Ashton, do you commit to raise little Ellie and Emily, but Ellie in the way of the Lord? Do you promise to be an example at the home, not just in your words, but she will capture the spirit? Do you promise in all words, actions, deeds that you will? Thank you. This is beautiful, to raise her in the way of the Lord, to love her, to let her be herself in her church, and to worship the Lord in her own little way. Do you, church, commit that as they raise little Ellie in the home, she's going to understand. Do you want it back? Okay. She's going to see the love of Christ in her home, but when she comes here, she cannot see a different picture. She needs to see a continuation of the love of Christ in her home. So do you as a church to commit to live holy, righteous, and pure? Show her that worshiping the Lord is exciting and it's real. And we run to the Lord when we have problems and we don't exhibit sin, but it is a house of worship, prayer, and praise. So when Ellie comes here, it's a continuation of home. If you do, say amen. Then let's have the privilege of dedicating little Ellie to the Lord. Tammy, I invite you to come. Why don't a couple of you guys come on here and we'll pray for Ellie and dedicate her. Ellie, the Bible says, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans for hope and a bright future. And today we dedicate you to a God that loves you way more than we could ever. Lord Jesus, I pray for little Ellie that she will grow up to be a giant of the faith, that we would look upon her commitment to you and be inspired to follow her lead. May the joy of the Lord fill her home. May this couple be committed to worship you, not just in church, but at home, at dinners, during the tough times and the frustrating times and the seasons that they're experiencing firsts. Lord, may they seek you. May Ellie and Emily see them run to you when they don't know the answer. And Lord, may she come to this church knowing that we will pray for her and all the children. We are committed to worship and give her something to see. That church is a family full of joy and worship and dependence upon you. Lord, should she ever go away, may we never cease to pray for her. And Lord, may we always pray for her coming home. May her parents have unconditional commitment and endurance to nurture her no matter what her choices. And Lord, may whenever we look at her, marvel at the wonderful creation of life that you have done. We dedicate her to you. This family dedicates her to you. Use her. She is yours. We love you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, let's celebrate with this family what God is doing.
May he be the king of our hearts. For every child, every parent, every adult, every person in this room, may he be the king of our hearts. King of my heart. Let the king of my heart be the mountain. And where I'm the fount. Oh, he is mine. Tell him, come on. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I'm the ransom for my life. Oh, he is mine. 'Cause you are good. You're good.
You're good. Oh, you are good.
right. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna. Come on, we sing it, we believe this. That you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let. No, you won't, no, you won't. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let.
God be praised. And all God's people said, amen. God is so good. Today we are excited to focus on what God is doing at Grove and to declare that I want in on what God is doing. I want in on what God is doing at Grove. The scriptures say that we can have fruit of the labor. You don't need to be in the hospital room to receive fruit or reward of the labor. You don't need to be standing on stage. Some of you would probably throw up in nervousness, but you can receive fruit of the labor. You don't have to work and serve if unable or absent at a certain day. You don't lose out your reward as long as you pray and serve and give. The scriptures say you receive fruit of the labor, and God is doing a lot of things in this church in order to provide opportunities for people to receive fruit of the labor. And so today I want to talk about how I want in. I hope your heart says I want into what God is doing, because I want to store up treasures in heaven for His glory and His glory alone. If you have your phones, go ahead and pull up Philippians chapter 4 in your Bibles. Philippians chapter 4, we'll start at verse 15. By way of introduction, I'd like to share with you many, many things that God is doing here at Grove, and continue the conversation about what God is doing to give you great, great motivation for this year in 2022 to one end. Many, many families, many, many people searching for churches are looking for where is God's activity. And I must say, before the praise of God, his glory alone, God is doing something here at Grove. I have never in my experience, in my ministerial experience, ever seen God's activity so vibrant, so large, huge, and for so long than what he's doing at Grove. I never have. I have seen punctuated moments of God's activity. I have seen moments and seasons that you look back, but we're starting year 3, folks, and I cannot believe what God is doing at Grove. And the scriptures say that as long as you pray and serve and give, you don't have to be the first responder in order to receive the reward or the fruit of the labor. And so today I want to encourage you, listen to some of these exciting things that God is doing here at Grove and say, I want in. This year, I want in. I will pray, I will give, I will serve. I will pray, I will give, I will serve in order to have fruit of the labor. I love that I've had to condense this list. And incidentally, I planned on sharing this last Sunday. And for those of you, it was a snow day. And for those of you that noticed, I felt compelled to call an audible and suspend the report because God was doing something else. We received a lot of emails. And I want to encourage you, we at the end of the broadcast, we encourage if you want to talk to me about anything, you can email me directly at pastor@groveav. As soon as we offered that out last week, we received so many encouragements saying, thank you for being sensitive to the Spirit. Our whole team, we just said, you know what? We're going to suspend this report and preach the word last Sunday. And the Lord did give increase. I shared a story last week about how our member care coordinator was asked to call a gentleman named Larry because he's open to receiving the gospel. He did call Larry. He did meet with Larry. Larry accepted Christ. He was 72 years old. And in fact, let's praise the Lord for that. And in the midst of a snow day, Larry decided to come and worship with us. And then I shared the story of how when Daryl initially tried to call Larry, he called the wrong number. And the gentleman on the other side of the line just happened to be Larry. And so for over 40 minutes, he's talking to another Larry about accepting Christ. And Larry would pray for Larry number 2 in this world somewhere who heard the clear gospel message. And then I get an email from a viewer and saying, I'm going to add Larry number 3 to your story. I said, you have got to be kidding. So on social media, we said, let's pray for all the Larrys out there. So if you know a Larry, this gentleman was struggling with COVID. He was in isolation. He that week had told his wife, just let me go. Just let me go. And when he listened to the service about Larry accepting Christ and how God never makes a mistake in his providential plan, it gave him hope to say, you know what? I have a reason for living, Larry number 3. Who knows what God is doing? And as you prayed for the Larrys of this week, you received fruit of that labor. So I want to give you all these exciting things that we believe God will do in 2022 and view them not as to us be the glory, but to God be the glory. Great things he is doing. I cannot say this enough, that in the educational system, we have committed to infuse the educational system with a Christian worldview, with a biblical worldview. Grove Christian School has just 9 more days of re-enrollment. If you are a current student, you must re-enroll because on February 1, 9 days from now, we're going to open it up to the community and it will max out. We will be turning people away. I want to encourage you to apply, to apply, to apply. February 1, we open it up to the entire community, and we will reach our highest attendance in Grove Christian School history. We will literally max out this facility at Grove 400. 2 years ago, we prayed that God would reach Grove 200, and in 2022, God will deliver. And to God be the glory, we say praise, great things he is doing. If you want a taste of Grove, I'm going to throw this out to you. And I really encourage you on, note this date, Friday, February 11th. Friday, February 11th, we are going to do 2 things. Grove Christian School has their homecoming games, and we want to absolutely blow out the facility. But the second thing we're doing, it is our official grand opening to all of our renovations that have occurred in the gym. We have now a 2-story athletic facility there. We are opening both sides, and we are going to recruit hundreds of you screaming people to literally intimidate the other team in the name of the Lord. We're literally going to come in. So if you know nothing about basketball, if you have no children or grandchildren at Grove Christian School, Friday, February 11th, 7:15 starts the men's varsity. We are going to just blow it out. Just come, eat the concessions. This is for fundraising for the school. So buy a ticket. I'm going to buy a ticket. Everyone's, so the funds go to the school. Come hungry, concessions. We have our custom-made Falcon Feed popcorn that place in Amarillo, Texas is making for us. No other recipe on the planet. They're all coming, and we are giving giveaways in the ladies' varsity games, 5:30, and then at 7:30, the men's varsity, and we have got a donor that is giving us hundreds of dollars of gift cards for all these athletic games. We'll have some for all the fans, and we have a donor who has actually donated $1,000 for a half-court shot. Somebody is going to win $1,000 on February 11th, and who knows what it'll be. Whatever age, you will be eligible. More details to come, but just go in there, grand opening of the facilities, and to celebrate what God is doing, and you will see firsthand the energy and the excitement of the joy of Christian education. February 11th, you'll hear more about that as well. Also, we have committed to bring awareness and to the church, because folks at Grove Christian in Christian School and Grove Church, we have something to say. We just don't want to be popular. We have something to say, the gospel of Jesus Christ. But the question is, there are not a lot of people that know that there's a church here, believe it or not. Do you know there are 27,000 vehicles that drive by this church every day? 27,000 vehicles that drive by this church each day, and I drove to four businesses just 0.1 mile away, and they had no idea a church was here. Now, why do we want to bring attention to a church is here? Not to make us popular, but to bring awareness. So there are three ways we're going to bring people in and make them aware of our gospel message. Not just any church, but we have something to say. We have the hope for the world. Therefore, we must do all we can to bring attention to the message of the gospel that's in this place. So if you recall, we have encouraged 2 weeks ago for everyone to go to their gyms, to their salons, to waiting rooms, to correctional facilities, assisted living centers, and say at 11 a.m., please, why don't you turn on the TV monitor to Grove Church. And by the way, if you have a business that turns on their TV, let me know, and we will welcome them to the broadcast at 11 a.m. as well. And go to a bar, not go to a bar, tell someone to go to the bar, and say, turn it on. By the way, if you're a believer and don't know someone that goes to a bar, we need to get you engaged in the world. I have lots of friends that respect us, but they're far from the Lord, and I encourage them, listen, think about Jesus, think about Jesus. So 11 a.m., I would love for all the saloons out there in Richmond to have the church service on and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I'll give them a shout out. I'll say, and listen, drink water, and listen to me. Jesus is the way of salvation for everybody. So I encourage you, go out. We've already had some people approach their businesses. We've also encouraged everyone to promote our social media. That is the free, quickest way to get the awareness of the gospel out. Grove Church, you can like us on Facebook. You can follow us on Instagram. I encourage you, by the way, if you're out there, grab your phones right now if you haven't. Grab your phones right now. Follow us on Facebook. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram. You can also go to our website, pastor@groveav.com. You can email me directly. Literally, like us, follow us, and then send it out to others. Within 3 years, we will have, we believe, viewership of this service online from all 50 states. And by 2030, we will have over 50,000 people watching online. And all of our digital efforts are absolutely free. But the more you pray, the more you give, the more you serve, you can have fruit of the labor. We have people right now in upstate Michigan actually huddling in their homes. They got a lot of snow. Love that you guys are there. This is their church. And you are receiving fruit of the labor. The more you give, the more you serve, and the more you pray. We encourage you also to do grassroots efforts in letting everyone know about what's happening as well. You notice that we put up banners on the streets. We're clearing out the fence line. We're going to raise the canopy on the Parham Ridge roadside so people can see what is happening here as well. We're also going to make a mark when people drive by to know that there's a church. We're going to have billboards, banners. In fact, if there's anything I've noticed is that we have this big, tall steeple and people literally drive by. Literally it's hard to fathom and don't even know what church is here. So this year I've asked the team to get quotes because we're going to illuminate that steeple. I want to become a landmark where people, they may not know what we do, they may not know what they say, but I want everyone who's given direction saying, look, you'll know you're on the right road when you see that big old illuminated steeple in that cross. At the cross, turn left. At the cross, turn right. I want people to know, and the more they recognize us as a landmark, the more they'll maybe look at some of our crazy fall bash parties and why there's 2,000 people here and say, maybe there's something happening on that intersection. I want to be a landmark so people know that there's a church here for the purpose of them hearing the gospel, no doubt. In addition, there's ways that you can get the gospel out and awareness of the ministry without even saying a word. We're going to create some Grove merchandise and dress everyone up like walking billboards. You're going to be able to walk. Every time I wear Grove merchandise and walk into Home Depot or something, I have a lot of people talk with me. And we're going to say, this is Grove Church. We're even going to dress up your babies. We're going to have merchandise to where the little ones can dress up. We're going to have onesies. We're going to have all these tumblers, all these just everything imaginable, and we're going to have walking billboards all around. We're going to have screensavers. We're going to have iPhone wallpaper. So when you walk away from your work computer, we're going to give you downloadable messages. So when your computer hibernates, it's going to be a gospel message, Grove Church. And so you can witness even when you're off the lunch at your cubicle, all the purpose to share the gospel and to get awareness. We are an election polling center. The community comes to this facility. And so we have searched out legal guidance, and we have found a way to legally, after they vote, in legal fashion, to invite people after they vote to come in and experience the facility, grant them free food, give them some workstations to work on if they just need a calm little step away before they return to the work or their families. Maybe they have an opportunity to pray. We'll fire up the auditorium. We'll share some praise and worship music for after everyone surrounding this building when they come to vote, legally and voluntarily, they can enter and integrate and engage our Grove family. We have the city coming in this building. We must do all we can to bring awareness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're going to draw an invite. We're going to have a big fall family bash that last year attracted 1,300 people, 400 families. This year we're praying for 1,500. We're going to have a summer kickoff and so on. And also, when people walk into this room, they are going to see a number of QR codes and images all across this campus. And they're going to see your face, and they're going to see a QR code that says, do you want to hear my story? Or let me share you a miracle, and then a QR code. I want to share with you how I got victory. And behind that QR code, they'll just be able to sit there, and they'll be able to scan it, and they're going to hear your testimony of how God saved your life. They're going to hear of how God got you over anxiety and depression and addiction. We're going to splatter this entire facility with QR codes so when strangers come in and they're just kicking back and their kids are having fun at some of our parties, they're going to hear your testimony. So in 2022 spring, we're going to solicit many of you to sit on a comfy couch and in front of a camera share your story of life change. All ages, all generations, all ethnicities to hear how God changed your life. And why do you worship the Lord Jesus? And they're going to connect with people like you. We will put it on the internet and we will spread it across literally the world. So if you feel so led that you believe you have an encounter where God showed you his miraculous power, or you believe there's a story that people should hear that would inspire them to consider Jesus Christ, we want you to email pastor@groveav.org and we will consider you to film your testimony for anyone who is watching. It'll be on our internet. It'll be all over this campus. It'll be on the QR codes for anyone that wants to hear your story. Because trust me, before they hear a pastor, they will listen to you. Because they can connect with you. You are in the life situation of them. You're in the right season of life with them, and they will gravitate to you. That Sunday, two people will be preaching your testimony and me. So we will solicit testimonies. We are already attracting multiple people, which I thought the garden at Grove would be just for our Grove family. We have people, we have over 100 already. It starts Tuesday. The women's ministry here starts this Tuesday. We have over 100 people already registered. We have more people from outside the community, some traveling almost an hour away to gather with the women of our church, some saved, some unsaved. We're doing everything we can to draw them in to hear the gospel. Behind that QR code is a registration opportunity for that. I encourage you this Tuesday, incredible, incredible sermon series, The Caring One, 8 encounters Jesus had with women and the takeaway from that on how we can trust him, love him, and serve him. Amazing testimony. In fact, it's so good I may just plagiarize Tammy this fall. And when guests come in this room, we will be committed to serve them. God is doing a lot, and so I want to encourage you, be involved. Do not miss out on the labor. You can serve at Grove. Behind that QR code, there is a survey where you can inquire. If you've already filled it out, that's awesome. We have an army of people serving. Just check off what you'd like more information about. We also have a survey for member care ministry. Member care ministry is incredible. As you pray and as you give and as you serve, you're able to see the firsthand miracles that God is doing firsthand. You may not be at the bedside, but you can serve and you can pray. And I want to create a further arm. We have over 100 people involved in that. I'll share with you something that member care happened just a few weeks ago. And I want you to know that even though you weren't their bedside, if you prayed and if you gave and if you served the Lord in this ministry, you did receive a reward. Not just Daryl Bishop, who was bedside. We had a member who, in a small group class, expressed a concern about her nephew who was approaching death. It was very clear, and it was sad. Unsure of his salvation, his name was Roy. Daryl went to the hospital and met with Roy. Roy had his nephew bedside as well. The hospital, Chippenham, wasn't about to let Daryl in until she realized he was clergy and they give us access. So he went to the bedside. Roy could not speak. He knelt down to Roy and whispered in his ear. And he said, Roy, you need to know where you will be. You need to know your eternal fate. Do you know, Roy? I don't know if you do. Here is the truth. And in his ear bedside, he explains to Roy the salvation message. Roy clings on to his nephew's arm as he's talking. He shares the gospel. How are we going to confirm if this man accepted Christ? And he said, Roy, I know you can't talk to me, but if you accepted Jesus Christ, squeeze his arm, start squeezing. And his nephew turned and said, Uncle, I too will be with you in heaven. God is doing something. You may not have been their bedside, but you can receive fruit of the labor. I encourage you to get involved in serving and giving and praying. We in our missions, we're partnering in missions both local and national. There'll be more of this starting in the summer and also definitely in the fall. But I've met with 4 different families talking about missions that have experience regarding missions, and COVID's kind of restricting the international travel right now. But we are imagining ways where we can, our theme is missions that leaves a mark. Missions that leaves a mark, not just inspires us, not just wanes after 2 weeks, but people come home and they inspire the people. They see different areas of the world and they see and they get inspired about not just opening the Bible to them, but also loving the world and seeing the need for global evangelism. We will go to Israel, but this is not bound just to Israel. We have a lot of connections all over the world. I already met with a couple people that gave me insights on different areas, and it will be extraordinary. And it's not just for youth. It is church-wide. We have more to come on our missions. Also, we're partnering with, in fact, I'm meeting with 2 other ministries on ways to partner and reach Richmond. They are very, very excited. They're not of our denomination, folks, but I can tell you some denominations are just a little off. They all preach that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He is the deity of Christ, the atoning death, and the resurrection. We vary on some peripherals, but when it comes to evangelizing, we're going to lock arms and we're going to reach the Richmond area. One of the local pastors told me at a breakfast, he said, I got to tell you, my mother, who is in her 90s, actually called me up and said, Son, you need to check out this church and consider running your church services this way. Well, you tell a pastor that, that's kind of stinging. Shane said, well, what church is it? It's Grove. He goes, Ben, so I swallowed my pride. And I clicked. And here was his words. Your service is such a natural flow of prayer and worship and preaching the word. I said, well, funny, did anyone tell you that? He goes, no, that's just what I saw. I said, that's what we strive to do. They also long to be a part of a ministry who uses this time to pray, to praise, and to proclaim God's word. We shared some ideas, and he said, I would love to partner with a church that when they gather, it is all about Jesus. So I commit to you in 2022. I know I don't have to share with you this point, but in 2022, we have found our personality. We have discovered and settled and cemented our conviction that in this worship service, we will do nothing but prayer and praise and preaching. Lots of things will grow. Lots of things will evolve. But one thing that will not change, we will always stand and proclaim the word of God. Philippians chapter 4 preaches and proclaims the need to pray and serve and give so that you receive a reward for all that is happening. I cannot tell you, I'm not bashful to say, give and support this church. Pray to support this church. Serve and support this church. Because the scriptures say that is how you can reap reward. Not all of you are in the life situation where you can stand bedside, or you can see the miracles of God, or you can see the business people that are literally, literally coming to Christ. But those are great excitements. As we report to you, you can say, praise the Lord, I supported that, and you know that you have set up treasures in heaven. Philippians chapter 4 is the last chapter of the book of Philippians. In the next coming days, in the next 7 weeks, we will overview the book of Acts, and we'll talk about that a little bit next week. We'll talk about their convictions, and we'll get there. But this is the last. Acts is all about how the church grew and developed. I don't want you to miss the next 7 weeks because it is a really interesting Bible study, and it's also interesting of how the seven top convictions of the early church, which we'll go over. But this is the last chapter of the last letter in the scheme of the book of Acts. He's writing the people of Philippi, and he's reflecting back on how much they supported him and prayed for him and gave to the work of the ministry. Verse 15, as you know, you Philippians were the only ones who gave me financial help when I first brought you the good news. And then I traveled from Macedonia. No other church did this. Note that phrase. Verse 16, even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent help more than once. That's a startling phrase culturally. Verse 17, I don't say this because I want a gift from you, but rather I want you to receive a reward for your kindness. I want you to receive a reward. Three things out of this passage that are really extraordinary that should motivate all of us to pray, support financially and through prayer and serving the ministry. He's writing a church that's 10 years old. The book of Philippians is 10 years after he first met them, Acts chapter 16. But in verse 16, you'll notice he says, even when I went to Thessalonica, you continued to support. Now, if you read Acts 16 and Acts 17, you will notice that after he established the church in Philippi in Acts 16, he immediately went to Thessalonica and went there one whole month. Literally, he started Philippi with meager beginnings, Acts 16, and then for the next 30 days, he starts Thessalonica. Now, you must know, now follow me on this, what makes verse 16 so extraordinary? The people of Philippi sent support, prayer support, financial support, serving support to him while he was in Thessalonica. The next 30 days. Now think about how this church started, what makes us so extraordinary. We could say he supported another church, Philippi supported another mission, great, but here's the thing. They did not wait to support God's activity. They started in Acts 16. If you know it, it was when they went in, there was women by the riverside. Lydia got converted. She was from Thyatira. She wasn't even supposed to be there. She was only there temporarily because she had a business that appealed to richer people and you exhaust the market and have to move on. Then there was a Philippian jailer and his whole family accepted Christ. That's when they sang and the bars shook and he said, what must I do to be saved? Then there was a demonic woman that historians believe got saved. So their whole church started with a Philippian jailer and his family, Lydia, rich merchant who had some other believers, women, and a former demonic maniac, and that was the start of their church. And you say, what can this church do? He leaves them, goes to Thessalonica the very next week, and he starts receiving support from this church. Support. Read verse 16. Even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent help more than once. This little church had something, call it naivety, call it simplicity. I don't care what you call it, but here's what happened. This church saw God's activity, saw bars shake, saw families get saved, saw traveling visitors accept Christ, saw the literal radical life change in a person, and they couldn't believe it. And the last verse of Acts 16, when he left Philippi, says, he rejoiced, continued spreading the gospel abroad. And that church was so excited about what God was doing in their house. When he went to Thessalonica, they're like, we want in. I'll give you whatever you need. And he's in Thessalonica, and 7 days later, he starts receiving support from this church. And again, starts receiving support from this church, financial help. Be like, what are they doing? They're just so excited about the activity of God. They experience firsthand, and they're like, I want in on this. This little church in 30 days gave so much. Earlier in chapter in Philippians, it says that within the 10-year season of Philippians' relationship with Paul, it says that they wanted to help Paul so much that they literally were tapped out. So they started sending people to Paul to find him. This church wanted in. Verse 15, as you know, Philippians, you were the only ones who gave. And then traveled from Macedonia, or when I first brought the good news and traveled to Macedonia, no other church did this. Listen to the churches that were in existence at this time. Antioch in Syria, that's where the church started, where everyone was called Christians. They did not offer support. Antioch in Pisidia, which is another church kind of off in the current Turkey. Iconium, church in Lystra, church in Derbe. No other church gave except for this little meager beginning church. But they had one thing, one ingredient true of them. They were so miraculously affected by the power of God and his activity. They're like, I want in on what he's doing there, and I want in on what he's doing there. And if you read 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 8 and 9, the church of Corinthians, he said to the church, Corinthians, Paul says, I did not take any money from you because I asked the brethren in Macedonia to support me. Even the church of Corinth is getting started by this little church because they didn't want to miss out on the eternal reward God was going to grant them. They couldn't travel with them. They couldn't go to Corinth with them, but they could pray, they could give, and they could serve. And notice verse 17. I don't say this because I'm asking right now for a gift, but rather I want you to receive a reward. A reward for your kindness. A reward. Note this, in various translations, this word sometimes reads the word fruit of your labor. The word karpos is in the Greek. It means fruit. But fruit can mean literal or figurative. Just like in the 21st century, we use fruit the same way. You can eat a piece of fruit, or you can have fruit of your labor. And if you're in business, you use this phrase, low-hanging fruit, kind of get the easy results. It's used in accounting. That means, back then, it meant a profit or an increase on your investment. We use it the same way. Farmers get fruit of their labor. Here it is, that's why this translation says reward. You get a reward. The reason why I have to celebrate what God is doing in this church is because literally, I cannot deprive you of the reward. And that first part of verse 17 is every pastor's feeling. I'm not telling you this to give it to me. I'm not telling you to give this to me. I'm telling you that when you give, you store up rewards in heaven. And I don't want to deprive you of the rewards in heaven. By the way, you want to make me proud? Don't give me money. Give it to the church. You want to make me proud? You give and invest and pray and serve and give and instill your investment in something that will bring you much more gain. That will make the little Ellies of the world become giants of the faith. Did you see little Emily dancing? It's her church and her joy. The fact that kids will walk into this room and say, this is my church. This is my Jesus. And I'm around a lot of people that actually like when I get excited. When you invest in the ministry, you receive reward in heaven because people's eyes are being turned to Christ. Notice these verses about fruit. Romans chapter 1, verse 13. Follow this. I work among you to see spiritual fruit just as I have seen among the Gentiles. Romans 7, 4. You've died, believer, to the power of the law. You are united now with the one who has risen from the dead. And as a result, you can produce a harvest of fruit. A harvest of fruit for God. Romans 6, 22, but now, since you, believer, have been set free from sin and have become committed to God, you have fruit. What is that fruit? Your persistent sanctification, and the outcome is eternal life. You can give and support for people to experience eternal life. Colossians 1, 6, the same good news that came to you going out all over the world, it is bearing fruit. Colossians 1, 6. It is changing lives just as it changed your life from the day you first heard and understood the truth that God is full of wonderful grace. I want you to say, I want in. I want in on what God is doing because I want your rewards, your fruit to be stored up in heaven. God is worthy to be praised. If there's anything you do in this life, if there is anything you do, make an eternal impact. 2022, we're going to make an eternal impact. Amen. Let's pray. Would you bow your head in prayer right now? As we make this a house of prayer, you can stand, sit, kneel, whatever posture is most conducive for you to pray to the Lord. I love that we all now just worship him as is most conducive for us to focus your attention on him. Pray two things. First, Lord, may you become famous in Richmond, not us. May you become famous in Richmond, not us. God, pray in your own words. God, would you use this ministry to bring the utmost glory to your name? Would you become famous in Richmond, not us? Give us opportunity, Lord. Give us opportunity to draw attention to your name. Even a shirt, even a screensaver, even a social media post. Lord, whatever it is, use it for your glory. We want more Larrys to come to the saving knowledge of Christ. More Roys who died just the next day. Lord, would you be famous in Richmond? Second prayer request. Lord, I want in. I want in. Show me what I can do to pray and give and serve. I want to store up rewards in heaven. Tell them, Lord, I don't want to be like the Pharisees in Matthew chapter 6, that they blew their trumpets and they received honor from people. Your scriptures say they just received their reward. And it's futile and it's fleeting and it's done. I want to store up rewards in heaven. God, show me how I can jump into the activity of God. I want in. I want in. I want in. Not for fame or glory, but I want in that your name be famous. Chat as you pray.
Effective servants that we could possibly be. But only through your power, God. Without you, we would be completely ineffective. Father, just light a fire under every single one of us. a fire that causes us to move, to obey, to go, to do whatever it is that you're calling us to do. God, you are so good. You are good. You are good all the time. And Father, forgive us for when we are not. But Lord, I just ask that whatever it is that's distracting us, whatever it is that's causing us to stumble, you would remove it. Lord, when you tell us to gouge out our eye if it causes us to sin, we understand you're not being literal, but at the same time, you are telling us it is a command to get out of whatever sin we're stuck in. It is a command to destroy the things in our lives that are keeping us from you. So God, before we can be effective servants, before we can go and preach the gospel, before we can go and minister to those who need hope, we have to have found that hope. We have to have accepted the gospel. Jesus, we know that just praying a prayer does not do anything, but it is the full submission to you, the repentance, the turning away from our sin, and the acknowledgement of you as King and Lord and Savior. That is what saves us. So God, today, purify your church. Someone who's called themselves a believer for 50 years, who has never truly come to know you, save them today. Let them find you truly for the first time right now. And Father, for those of us who are firm in the faith, we are believers. Dust us off. Remove the things in our lives that do not need to be there. And help us to fill our hearts and our minds with the things of you that is holy and good and true and pure. Let your church, just from the overflow of the heart, preach the gospel and live the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen.
And all of God's people said, amen, amen. If you're here as our guest, we are so glad that you're here. You're part of the Grow family. I hope you feel at home. We have a very special gift, a very cool gift for you. If you haven't yet, just stop by the Welcome Center, see Donna and her team, and we would love to grant you that gift as well. My wife and I will remain up here. We would love to meet you even before you go out there. Just shake your hand and make your acquaintance. Folks, God is going to do something great. 2022, God is going to do something great. And I want in, and I want you in too. God bless you. I hope you have a great week. We'll see you next week.